welcome to each one of you. We're so glad you're here to worship the Lord with us today. At this time, I will call upon Sandeep Dave to lead us in a word of prayer. And incidentally, Sandeep and Aprajita were blessed with a baby, and this is his first time being a father, and we rejoice along with them. So Sandeep, please lead us in a word of prayer.
Thank you, Father, for this day, this time given to us. Lord, bless this service, God. Help us so we can hear your word, God, and help us to apply your words in our life. Lord, you bless this coming week. May your name be glorified, may your will be done, God. We want to give you all the glory and praise. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
The first song we're going to sing is a hymn, a very well-known hymn called Diadem, but probably better known as All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. And I think one of my favorite lines in the song is the line that says, Hail him who saves you by his grace, because we are saved by God's grace and God's grace alone and nothing else.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and
that we just sang says, to him all majesty ascribe. So let's sing majesty, worship his majesty.
Majesty, worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. From his throne unto him.
Going to sing. It is one of our family favorites. It's Gata Rahe Mere Dil, Teri Prashansa Bar Bar, which is My Heart Will Sing Your Praises, O Lord.
Gata Rahe Mere Dil.
Kids church every other Sunday for the rest of the year. That means we had kids church last Sunday, so we will not have it today, but we will have it next Sunday. And so we will go on like that till the end of the year. So this time presenting to you the kids song.
Hallelujah, 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 praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Song by Dr. Vinita Murali, who is an ophthalmologist from CMC Vellore. She also got her MSc in counseling and psychotherapy. And we haven't met face to face, but we were introduced by a common friend and we've been messaging each other. And she has been playing the keyboard and organ for over 40 years. And recently she started uploading some of her songs on YouTube. And today we will hear the song, His Eye is on the Sparrow.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home when Jesus is my portion?
It's been an absolute joy studying 1 Kings chapter 17, 18, and 19 with you over the past several weeks. Hasn't it been wonderful? We've been looking at stories that we've listened to over and over again. We've heard those stories in Sunday school. We've read those stories many times. And yet, God has spoken to us in really deep and personal ways. And we want to return to Him thanks.
One of the greatest joys for me as I've done this series, just like us, looking at the prophet Elijah, is how God has taken his word and spoken to people specifically in their area of need. Even last week, I praise God that God helped one person to be able to deal with their own fears in response to the message from the heart of God. You remember, we looked at 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 1 to 9 last week. The prophet Elijah in chapter 17 and 18 is this fiery man of God being used in the most powerful ways. But as you come down to chapter 19, the fiery man of God now feels like a failure. He's going through the lowest valley in his walk of faith. Oh, he is running for his life. And as we looked at 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 1 to 9, I placed before you five warning signs. Five warning signs that we need to be careful about that we pick up from the life of the prophet Elijah. Number one is the warning sign of fear. When you stop living by faith and start living by fear. Number two is the warning sign of being out of fellowship with God. Number three is the warning sign of forsaking our friends and family and wanting to be alone. Number four is the warning sign of losing focus on the purposes of God and beginning to focus upon ourselves. And number five is fatigue. A man who is extremely tired, going through a great valley of pain in his journey of faith with the one who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What is beautiful, however, is that as you continue reading the story of Elijah, the man who is running will soon be returning. The man who is running will soon be returning. This message is entitled, From Running to Returning. We're looking at 1 Kings chapter 19. We're going to look at verses 9 down to verse 18. 1 Kings chapter 19, beginning at verse 9. The Bible says, There he went into a cave and spent the night. The word of the Lord came to him, What are you doing here, Elijah? He replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, put your prophets to death with a sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me. The Lord said, Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart, shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, What are you doing here, Elijah? He replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and put your prophets to death with a sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too. The Lord said to him, Go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. When you go there, anoint Hazael, king of Aram, anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king of Israel, anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel-Meholah to succeed you as prophet. Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him. What a beautiful passage of scripture. Like I said to you, as I look at 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 9 to 18, my theme for this particular message is the prophet who is running is now returning. From running to returning. As I read those verses for you this morning, I don't know how many of you were able to outline those verses. I wish we could talk to one another face to face, because I would have been able to hear your outlines. And sometimes I must confess that your outlines may be far better even than my own. And that's a very important thing for us to keep in mind. Please write down your own outlines and use your own outlines as you teach these glorious stories to others in the circle of your influence. This morning, as I look at 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 9 to 18, I have four lessons that I want to pass on to you. How did this man who is running now winds up returning to fulfill the purposes of God? Four lessons that I'd like you to write down in your Bible. Number one, the word of God. Number two, the whisper of God. Number three, the work of God. And number four, the witnesses of God. Let me just quickly go through those four lessons again. Number one, the word of God. Number two, the whisper of God. Number three, the work of God. And number four, the witnesses of God. As we look at 1 Kings chapter 19 and begin to read the first 9 verses, we see how the prophet Elijah is afraid, he's anxious, he's run away. And one of the things you realize in the passage of scripture that I read for you today is that the prophet Elijah is quite adamant. In fact, when God asks him the same question, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Look with me at verse 9. "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And then come down to verse 13. "What are you doing here, Elijah?" God asks him the same question. And when God asks him the same question, it's interesting that Elijah gives God the same answer. In fact, it's interesting that as you read verse 10 and as you read verse 14, you realize that verse 10 and verse 14 are an exact, absolute exact copy of the other. He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too." You realize, as you look at this conversation that God has with the prophet Elijah, that the prophet Elijah is not just afraid, he's not just anxious, he is absolutely adamant at this particular point in his life. You'd remember that when the prophet Elijah met Obadiah, and he said to Obadiah, "I have come to meet Ahab," Obadiah already told him. He said, "Elijah, I have hid 100 prophets of Yahweh God, 50 in 2 caves, and I have preserved them through this period of the drought." So the prophet Elijah knew that there were other servants of God who had not bowed down to the Baal. In fact, when you look at 1 Kings chapter 18, as Elijah is praying, he's sending out his servant again and again to see if there is a sign of rain in the skies. And the servant comes back 6 times and says, "There is no sign," until the 7th time he comes back and says, "I see a cloud as big as a man's hand." Remember, there were other men, there were other women who had not bowed down to the Baal, and the prophet Elijah knew that. And yet at this particular point of history, as God is speaking to this man, he is afraid, he is anxious, he's angry, and in some ways he's adamant. He's saying to God the same thing, "I'm the only one left, I'm the only one left, and they want to kill me." And yet as you come to the end of this particular passage of scripture, the prophet Elijah returns back and accomplishes God's beautiful purposes for his life. And as I look at this particular passage of scripture, I realize that there are 4 very important things that happen in the life of the prophet Elijah for him to be a man who returns from a place where he is running, from running to returning. Number one, the word of the Lord. The word of the Lord. Look with me at 1 Kings chapter 19. I am reading to you at verse 9. The Bible says, "There he went into a cave in the night, and the word of the Lord came to him. That's the first verse I want you to mark in your Bible. This man who is running will return back to accomplish God's purposes for his life because he heard the word of God again. When you study the life of the prophet Elijah, it's very interesting. Look with me at 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse 1. When he comes and stands before Ahab and he confronts Ahab, he says to Ahab, "As surely as the Lord God of Israel lives whom I serve." He stands before Ahab as a man sent by God. He stands before Ahab as a man having heard the word of God. Look at 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse 2. The moment he speaks to King Ahab, the Bible says, "Then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, 'Leave here eastward and hide in the Kereth Ravine.'" He comes and stands before Ahab because of the word of God. He runs down to the Kereth Ravine because of the word of God. Chapter 17 and verse 8, "Then the word of the Lord came to him, 'Go at once to Zarephath.'" He stands before Ahab because of the word of God. He goes to the Kereth Ravine because of the word of God. He goes to Zarephath because of the word of God. Chapter 18 and verse 1, "After a long time, in the third year, the word of the Lord came to Elijah, 'Go and present yourself to Ahab, and I will send rain on the land.'" The word of the Lord comes to the prophet Elijah, and he goes and he stands before Ahab, and he tells Ahab that God is going to send rain upon the land. When he stood to confront Ahab, he stood on the strength of the word of God. When he went to the Kereth Ravine, where the ravens fed him, he went listening to the word of God. When he moved to Zarephath, he moved listening to the word of God. When he came back with the news that God was going to send the rain, he came back having heard the word of God. But as you read 1 Kings chapter 19, when he hears these words from Jezebel, when Jezebel sends word to Elijah and says, "Elijah, as you have done to the prophets of Baal, I will do to you," the Bible records to us that Elijah no longer hears the word of God. A man who has been consistently hearing the word of God, a man whose every move has been in so many ways rooted upon the word of God, for the first time in his life stops listening to the word of God and begins to run in fear and runs into this great valley of pain. And now as you see God restoring this man, as you see God bringing this man back to a place where from where he's running, he's going to be returning back to accomplish the purposes of God, you realize it starts with the word of God. And this morning I want to tell you that one of the most important places to go to be able to come through our valley experiences, to be able to recover from those times when we are discouraged and depressed, feel defeated, is to get back to the word of God. I was reading a couple of illustrations about the word of God a couple of weeks ago, and I want to share them with you. A man was walking down the streets one day, and it was getting dark, and a voice spoke to him. And the voice said to him, "Pick up a few pebbles and put them in your pocket. Tomorrow you will be glad. Tomorrow you will be sorry." The man was wondering what this voice was about, and so in obedience he picked up a few pebbles, he put them in his pocket. It was late in the night, he went off, and the next day morning he got ready again, and as he began to journey, he put his hand into his pocket and he felt those pebbles. When he pulled them out, yes, he was glad. You know why? Because all of those pebbles were the most precious diamonds. He was glad and yet he was sorry. You know why he was sorry? He was sorry because he hadn't picked up much more and put it into his pocket. And oftentimes that's the way in which many of us will feel when it comes to God's word. Oh, the word of God is like a precious treasure. As we read the word of God, God speaks to us in such amazing ways. And yet, isn't it true that so many of us feel sorry that we haven't spent enough time meditating on the word of God? How amazing it is that the recovery of the prophet Elijah happens as God's word comes back to him again. I read a sad but true story a few weeks ago. Now, this is my second illustration about the Word of God. And this is a true illustration that happened in the Yellowstone National Park. It seems there was a man who was visiting this park, and one of the things that caught his attention was the number of posters that said, "Do not feed bears." And yet, as he went through the Yellowstone National Park, he found that many people were constantly trying to feed the bears. At the end of the of his experience at this particular park, he met the park ranger. And he said to the park ranger, "Sir, today I noticed something that is a total contradiction of all of these posters that you put up." And the park ranger said, "Sir, I want to tell you something. You know, when we put these posters, people often think we don't want them to feed the bears because the bear may attack them. But you know something, there is something that is far more terrible that happens because people feed the bears. Because the people feed the bears get so used to eating the food that people give them. And then when the park closes down, when the park closes down because of difficult weather conditions, the bears have to fend for themselves. But you know what's happened to these bears? They've become so used to being fed by people that the bears are no longer able to go out and find food for themselves. Every single year, we pick up so many dead bears at the Yellowstone National Park. You know why? Because those bears have forgotten how to go and find their own prey." Now, when I read that particular story, I was thinking of how sad it is that in many of our lives, we have become like those bears. You know, many of us have become so used to listening to sermons on YouTube. Not that it's bad. You're listening to my sermon, and I'm grateful to God for that. Many of us are so used to listening to a morning devotional. Not that it's bad. Many of you receive my morning devotional, and I thank you for listening to those devotionals. Many of you are just so happy just reading a daily bread devotional. Many of you are so happy just receiving God's word from here and there. But the sad thing is that many of us are not spending time alone with God's word and studying God's word for ourselves. One of the most important places where men and women of God find renewal in their spiritual walk, one of the sure ways of being able to come out of a valley experience and begin to climb the mountaintops again, is to get alone with the Word of God. Elijah the prophet begins to move from a place of running to returning because he again receives the Word of God. Secondly, the whisper from God. The whisper from God. I want to read for you verses 9 down to verse 13. "And the word of the Lord came to him, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?' He replied, 'I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too.' Then the word of the Lord said, 'Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by.'" Now, as we stop there for a moment this morning, look at verse 8 with me. As you look at verse 8, the Bible says, "Elijah, strengthened by the food that God gave him, traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of the Lord." Until he reached Horeb, the mountain of the Lord. Now, when you think about Horeb, the mountain of the Lord, this was a very, very important place in terms of the history of God's people. This is where Moses encountered God at the burning bush. This is where God gave the household of Israel the Ten Commandments. And every time I read the story of God giving the household of Israel the Ten Commandments, I come down to chapter 33. That's the chapter of the golden calf. You know, Moses is on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights, and God is giving him the Ten Commandments, and the household of Israel grows impatient. And so what do? They cast a golden calf, and they are worshiping that golden calf. And you know the story. Moses comes down, his heart is broken, and Moses pleads in the presence of God. And as he pleads in the presence of God, God will tell Moses something. God will tell Moses, says, Moses, you lead this people. I am not coming along with them because this is a stiff-necked people. And if I go with them, they will actually be put to death. Moses says, God, if you do not go, we do not move. And then God speaks to Moses. And God says to Moses, Moses, I have heard your cry. Moses, I have heard your prayer. And I am going to do the very thing you want me to do. And at that particular point, it's very interesting. God has already answered Moses' prayer. And if I was Moses, I would be jumping up and down and saying, God, I thank you that you've answered my prayer. I thank you that you're going again with us. I would have called the household of Israel and said, God is going with us. But you see, at that particular point of history, Moses turns around to God and says, God, I have one request, God. You know what that request is? God, will you please show me your glory. God, will you please show me your glory? If you turn with me in your Bible to Exodus chapter 33 for a moment, in that particular context, this is what God tells Moses. Exodus chapter 33, I'm going to read to you verses 21 down to verse 23, verses 21 to 23. The Bible says, then the Lord said, there is a place near me where you may stand on a rock. When my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hands until I have passed. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen. You see, Moses cries out to God saying, God, please show me your glory. You know what God says? God says, okay, Moses, I'm going to pass by and I'm going to give you an opportunity to see my glory. Every time I read Exodus chapter 33, I ask myself the question, why did Moses want to see the glory of God? Why did Moses, after God had said to him, I'm going to do the very things you've asked me, just after that, why does he say, I want to see the glory of God? And as I begin to think of it more deeply, I begin to realize that Moses, the man of God, got it perfectly. You know what Moses is saying? Moses is saying, God, if only I get a glimpse of your glory, I'm able to go back and lead a people who are stiff-necked. I'm able to go back to the most difficult circumstances if only I get a glimpse of your glory. Now, as you come down to the story of Elijah the prophet in 1 Kings chapter 19, that's exactly what God is doing again. God is telling the prophet Elijah, go out and stand in the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Oh, Elijah, I am going to show you my glory. Oh, Elijah, I'm going to show you who I am. Oh, Elijah, I'm going to reveal to you my great power. And when I do that, Elijah, when you see me, then the problems of your life, the Jezebels of your life become mighty small. When we look at the glory of God, the problems in our life become mighty small. Or the song that we sing so often, turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of the earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and his grace. Most of us have done this. If you haven't done it recently, maybe you can do it at the end of the service. Go out on a sunny day and look at the sun. And the moment you look at the sun, you come back into your house. And guess what happens? You have eyes and yet you grope around like a blind person. And that's exactly what the songwriter says. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face. And all of the things of the earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and of his grace. And that's exactly what Moses understood. He said, God, show me your glory. My problems are huge, God. I'm leading a rebellious people. I'm in enemy territory. I don't know what the future holds. Show me your glory. Because when I look at you, Lord, the things of the earth grow strangely dim in the light of your glory and of your grace. And as you come to 1 Kings chapter 19, that is exactly what God is doing with the prophet Elijah. God is encountering with the prophet Elijah in this beautiful passage of scripture. I put down three words as I think of God's encounter with the prophet Elijah. Number one, I put down the word glory. This is God in some ways revealing his glory to the prophet Elijah. Number two, I put down the word gentleness. This is God meeting the prophet Elijah in gentleness. The Bible says when Elijah went and when God asked Elijah to go and stand on the mountain, there was a great and powerful wind, but God was not in the wind. And the Bible says there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And then the Bible says there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And then the Bible says there was a whisper. And when that whisper was heard, Elijah drew out of the cave and stood there and wanted to listen to the one who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. God reveals his glory in gentleness and in his grace. What I find so beautiful as I look at this particular passage of scripture is that Elijah, the man of God, from 1 Kings chapter 17 down to chapter 18, has got so used to seeing all of these big things happening. He confronted Ahab, fed by the ravens, the widow at Zarephath, her oil and flour doesn't run out. Oh, he has raised back to life the son of the widow at Zarephath. He prayed and fire fell down on Mount Carmel. What has Elijah seen? He's seen all of these big and powerful exploits of God. And in some ways, Elijah, the man of God, got so totally consumed with these big and powerful encounters of God that he completely forgot that place of his close communion with God. And therefore, as God encounters with the prophet Elijah on the Mount of Horeb, there is a mighty wind, there is an earthquake, there is a fire, but God is not in the wind, God is not in the earthquake, God is not in the fire, because God is trying to tell the prophet Elijah, Elijah, I want you to listen to me. You've been so carried away by all of these big things that have happened that you've forgotten the most important thing. And the most important thing is to be able to hear my whisper. The most important thing is to be in that place where you listen to my voice. The most important thing is to encounter with me, Prophet Elijah. David Jeremiah says something that I think is beautiful. He says, when somebody whispers, you know what we have to do? We have to strain to listen. When somebody is whispering, we have to strain to listen. And he's saying, in some ways, that's the experience of the prophet Elijah. As God whispers, the prophet Elijah has to intentionally quieten his heart and listen to God as he would speak to him in deep and personal ways. Maybe there's somebody this morning, you're so caught up with all of the big activities, the big programs, you're running from one place to the other, and right now you are feeling tired, right now you're feeling weak, right now you're feeling like a failure. Maybe this morning what you need to experience is the experience of the whisper of God. Stories told of Major Ian Thomas. Who is Ian Thomas? He was the founder of the Capenry Mission Fellowship. Who is this man? He was the founder of the International Torchbearers. Oh, this great man of God. When he began his ministry, he was so involved in doing things for God. He was going from one place to the other, trying to preach at every opportunity he got, trying to be at every meeting that he could be at, trying to meet people all the time, trying to evangelize people all the time. And yet he was an empty man. He was trying to do all of these big and powerful things for God, and yet nothing was happening in his life. One day, completely discouraged, one day completely disheartened, Ian Thomas lay down and said, God, I want to give up. And in that moment, as he went through the valley, all of a sudden in his mind, he began to hear these words, Christ, who is our life. Christ, who is our life. And Ian Thomas did not even know where that verse was. He knew he'd read it, but he did not know where that verse was. And so he jumped out of that experience, pulled out his Bible, and he began to look at that verse. He found it in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 4. Christ, who is our life. And that day, he says, changed everything. He said, until that particular point, I was doing a lot of things in my own strength. Now I begin to realize that Christ is my life. Christ wants to live through me. Christ wants to speak through me. Christ wants to touch lives through me. The very next day, Ian Thomas was asked to speak to 90 young people in a youth fellowship. Before he went to that youth fellowship, he stopped and he said, God, would you speak through me? Christ living in me. Christ who is my life. And that day, as he spoke to those 90 children, 30 of them gave their heart to the Lord Jesus Christ. As I look at the prophet Elijah, he is a man who is returning from a place of running. Number one, he has received the word of God. Number two, he's experienced the whisper of God. Number three, God tells him about the work of God. God has a work for the prophet Elijah. Look with me at your Bible. I want to read to you verses 15 down to verse 17 of 1 Kings chapter 19. The Lord said to him, go back the way you came. Go to the desert of Damascus. And when you get there, anoint Hazael, anoint Jehu, and anoint Elisha. Now, as you look at that particular section of the scriptures, God is actually telling Elijah two things. You know what God is telling Elijah? Number one, God is telling Elijah, I've got a task for you. It's an important task, Elijah. I want you to go back. And as you go back, I want you to anoint these three people. I want you to anoint Hazael. I want you to anoint Jehu. And I want you to anoint Elisha. Now, I find that itself encouraging. Who is the prophet Elijah? He is discouraged. He's run away. He has taken away in fear. What is God doing? God is telling Elijah, Elijah, I've got an important work for you to do. I want you to go back and I want you to anoint these three men. But you know what is even more interesting to me as I look at this particular passage of scripture? God is not simply sending Elijah to anoint these three men. God is sending Elijah to accomplish the glorious task that he started through Elijah's life. Look with me at your Bible. Let me read for you verse 17. The Bible says, Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. You know what God is telling Elijah? Elijah, the reason I sent you to confront Ahab was this. The Israelites had turned their backs on me. And what did they started to do? They started to worship Baal. They had prostituted themselves with all kinds of evil. So what did I want to do? I wanted to remove all of this evil from the midst of my people, and I wanted to bring a renewal and a revival among my people. Elijah, I used you. In 1 Kings chapter 17, you confronted Ahab. On the Mount of Carmel, 450 prophets of Baal were removed, and you have done your part. But Elijah, there is still work to be done. Elijah, there is still work to be accomplished. And here's what I want you to do. You're my man. I want you to go back and I want you to anoint these three people. Anoint Hazael, anoint Jehu, anoint Elisha. And you know what I'm going to do through those three people? I'm going to accomplish what I started to do in and through you. Isn't that beautiful? The one who has called us is faithful. You know, so many times in our own lives, we become discouraged. So many times in our own lives, like the prophet Elijah, we feel like giving up. And yet, what is beautiful is that the one who has called us is faithful, and he will fulfill his task. The one who has called us is faithful, and he will accomplish his task in and through our lives. I find it so beautiful that God sends Elijah back and says, Elijah, I've still got work for you to do. And as Elijah comes back to do the work of God, God in so many ways restores this his servant. This morning, one of the places we need to be at when we want to have that restoration in our life is to get alone with the Word of God. The second thing that we need to experience as we seek the restoration of God is to listen to the whispers of God. You know, many times you're so caught up with wanting the big and the mighty things to happen, but God wants to encounter with us one-on-one. He He is whispering, and we need to learn to listen to Him. Shut off all distractions and listen to His still but sweet voice. I need the Word of God. I need the whisper of God. And this morning, I need to remember that God still has a work for you and me. You know, oftentimes when I think of the works of God, I'm so encouraged that, you know, God uses ordinary people. There are sometimes, you know, we think to ourselves, you know, I'm not a preacher, I'm not a teacher, I'm not a pastor, I'm not some great person. But you know something, God is a God who uses ordinary people for His purposes. And this morning, God still has a work for you, my friend. I often tell the story of Edward Kimball. In 1854, this Sunday school teacher, led by the Holy Spirit, went to talk with a young man who was in so many ways disinterested about the things of God. You know the story. It was D.L. Moody that Edward Kimball spoke to about Jesus Christ. The rest is history. D.L. Moody came to the saving grace of Jesus. Many people say that hell was depopulated of at least 2 million people because of the ministry of D.L. Moody. You know, the story doesn't end there. D.L. Moody had the joy of leading a great pastor by the name of F.B. Meyer to the Lord, or Meyer to the Lord. So Edward Kimball leads D.L. Moody. D.L. Moody leads F.B. Meyer. And then he went on to lead Wilbur Chapman to the Lord. Wilbur Chapman went on to lead Billy Sunday to the Lord. Billy Sunday influenced a man by the name of Mordecai Ham. And Mordecai Ham was the man who had the privilege of leading Billy Graham to the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And it all started with an ordinary man whose name is Edward Kimball. And in so many ways, just as God spoke to Elijah and said, Elijah, the work that I started through you, I'm not going to abandon that work. That will be completed. And you've got a task to do. Go back and anoint these three men because I am going to accomplish my task. And this morning, God is speaking to you as He's speaking to me. And He's saying to us this morning, I have a plan. I have a purpose. I have a work for you to do. And one of the places where we find revival, one of the places where we find renewal is when we get back and do the work of God. Number one, the Word of God. Number two, the whisper of God. Number three, the work of God. And finally, number four, the witnesses of God. As I look at verse 18, God says something very interesting to the prophet Elijah. He says, Elijah, yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to the Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him. You know what Elijah has been saying in verse 10 and verse 14? I'm the only one. I'm the only one. There's nobody like me. Now in verse 18, God says, Elijah, I want to tell you, there are my witnesses spread all around. There are my witnesses. And I think in some ways, it was important for Elijah to hear about these witnesses of God. Because as I think about these witnesses of God, two words come to my mind. Number one, the faithful men and women. You know, Elijah needed to hear that there were other faithful men and women. And that was something that encouraged the prophet Elijah from running to returning because he sees that there are other faithful men and women. Every time I read the stories of Sadhu Sundar Singh, I tell this one story. This is about Sadhu Sundar Singh going to Tibet, right? When he went to Tibet, Sadhu Sundar Singh was thinking to himself, I am the first person who's come to this region to tell people about Jesus Christ. And then one day as he was preaching in that Tibetan region, he was caught by a group of people who began to persecute him. And at the end of that persecution, they said, if you don't leave this region, we will do to you what we did to Kartar Singh. Now, Sadhu Sundar Singh had never heard of the name Kartar Singh. He was intrigued. He said, who is this Kartar Singh? He went out to try and find out. Kartar was a 19-year-old boy who accepted Jesus Christ. He was the only son of his parents. They were a very, very wealthy family, and Kartar accepted Jesus Christ. His family did everything to discourage him, but Kartar still wanted to walk with Jesus Christ until finally, one really cold winter day in Patiala, Kartar Singh's father stripped him naked in front of the whole family. And he said, if you want to walk with Jesus, the door is open, get out. Kartar was standing there naked in front front of his father, he looked at his father and he said, "Daddy, you see me naked. I am clothed with the righteousness of Jesus Christ." He went off to the Tibetan regions, and as he preached in the Tibetan regions, history records for us that he was arrested and they killed him in the most painful manner. They wrapped his body with yak skin and left him in the sun. And as the yak skin began to constrict in his body, this was the most painful death. And as he went through that struggle, the people said, "If only you turn your back on Jesus, we'll set you free." And Kattar said, "Nothing doing. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back." And Sadhu Sundar Singh was so deeply challenged by the life of Kattar Singh. Here is Sadhu Sundar Singh thinking, "I'm the only one in Tibet." And God is reminding Sadhu Sundar Singh that I have other witnesses that have witnessed in these areas. And in some ways, that's what God is doing to the prophet Elijah. I have other faithful men and women, 7,000 of them, who have not bowed down to Baal. How amazing is that? So many times when we go through those seasons of depression, when we go through those seasons of brokenness, the stories of other faithful men and women have a way of encouraging us and bringing us out of our valley experiences to those places where we are able to walk with Him who is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Oh, the word of God came to Elijah. Oh, the whisper of God that Elijah experienced. Oh, the work of God that God had for the prophet Elijah. And finally, the witness of God, the faithful witnesses of God. And secondly, I think in some ways, as God speaks to Elijah about those 7,000 people who have not bowed their knees to Baal, it also talks of the fruitful ministry of Elijah. Because I think in some ways, Elijah is possibly saying, "God, what is the use of my ministry? I've confronted Ahab. I've been in the Kereth Raven. I've been in Zarephath. I've seen the fire fall down. What's been the use of my ministry?" And God is saying, "Elijah, I want to tell you something. I can show you faithful men and women. And I also want to tell you that your ministry has been fruitful. Your ministry has been fruitful in encouraging these 7,000 people to continue to walk with me." And oftentimes, that's something that we don't see. You know, when we work for God, we only see what we are able to see. We don't see what God is working out through our lives. God is working out His amazing purposes. Oh, there was a pantheon of people who are walking with God because of the ministry of the prophet Elijah. And God, in some ways, is encouraging Elijah, saying, "Elijah, you have been a fruitful servant. Look at my witnesses. Your life has challenged them." You know, a couple of weeks ago, I went down to one of our schools out here in Kolkata called the Gospel Home School. And I went there for a chapel inauguration. And when I went there for that chapel inauguration, the principal of the school introduced me to a young man. And he said, "Oh, this young man, God has been working in his life in amazing ways. And he's decided to walk with Jesus Christ." And so I was very pleased. I shook the young man's hand. He was a tall young man. And I smiled at him. And a few minutes later, the principal then came along and said, "Oh, this is the young man's mother." And the young man's mother again wished me, and I wished her. And I was wondering to myself, who is this young man? Who is this mother? Why is the principal introducing them to me? Maybe there was a mistake of some sorts. And so I sat down in the program and I kept looking at the young man often. I was wondering to myself, who is this young man? At the end of the service, after I finished my meal, I was walking towards my car to drive away from the school when the mother came running to me along with her son. And she said, "Sir, I want to thank you." And I looked at her and I said, "But I don't know who you are." She said, "Sir, I want to thank you. 2.5 years ago, I went through the biggest crisis of my life. I didn't think there was a future in my life. One of my relations contacted you, sir, and you called the authorities of the school and you pleaded with them to give my son an opportunity in the school, sir. Because of that, my son got a good education. Because of that, my son grew in his walk with Jesus Christ. Because of that, my son gave his heart to Jesus Christ. Sir, I want to thank you. Because of you, my family has been blessed and changed forever." And as I was driving back from the school, I was saying to myself, "God, I don't even remember. I don't even remember this phone call that I placed to say a kind word to help somebody." And you know, God in some ways is encouraging the prophet Elijah. "Elijah, you think you are not fruitful, but I have used you in special ways. the prophet returning from running. How did it happen? Number one, the word of God. Number two, the whisper of God. Number three, the work of God. And number four, the witnesses of God. As we close our service this morning, we're going to sing that glorious, glorious song. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me, God. Have thine own way. And as we sing that song, would you make it your prayer this morning saying, God, I want to return to your word. I want to listen to your whisper. I thank you that you've got works for me to do. And I thank you, Lord, for the witnesses of Jesus Christ all across the globe, faithful men and women. And I thank you, God, for the little that I do that is fruitful in your service. Every eye closed, every head bowed. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father, this morning, we want to thank you so much for those encouragements from the prophet Elijah. Oh, this man who is running is now returning because, Lord, in a fresh way, he's encountered the word. In a fresh way, he's listened to the whisper. In a fresh way, he has been encouraged that you have a work for him to do. And Lord, in a fresh way, his heart rejoices in those faithful witnesses and the fruit of his own labor. And this morning, Lord, this morning we thank you that it is your desire to encourage us who are discouraged, oh God. This morning, if there is somebody who's going through discouragement, if there is somebody who is going through depression, if there is somebody who feels defeated, Lord, I pray that you would bring them back to the word of God. I pray that you would whisper into their lives. I pray that they would remember that you have a work for them to do. And I pray, Lord, that your witnesses will be an encouragement to their lives. And so, Lord, be glorified in us, be glorified through us this morning. This is our prayer. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. We ask with a grateful heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. In closing and in response to God's word this morning, we want to close this meeting in prayer by saying, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now, as in thy presence humbly I bow. Shall sing Christ only, always living in me.
And Father, this morning, that's our prayer. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. And now we pray that the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of us, both now and forevermore. Amen.